Welcome, welcome, come on in. Welcome to the feast. We have a feast here of information and good spiritual humor. And our mission here, purpose, is to sidestep something that is coming in the world. There's something coming in this world that sidestepping it would be a very good idea. How to sidestep it? We hear all of these prophetic talk about the future, what's going to happen, and we're getting a clearer and clearer idea of what is going to happen. But there's not enough talk about what to do about it. How do we sidestep this, the troubles to come? How do we sidestep it? Various traditions have various remedies. Christian traditions is the rapture, you know, get off of this planet somehow. Well, fine, but you know, how does that happen? Or the ascension, or the shift, or the exodus, or something? Well, that's what we focus on here. This is our focus. Now, what's going to happen in the world, we talk about that too. But what are our ascension attitudes? What are our sidestepping attitudes? This is what's very important. What is the nature of God? How can we be helped? It doesn't do us much good if we know the date, if we don't know what to do about it once we reach that date. So we go through this information carefully, and it's shockingly good news, actually, shockingly great news. The nature of God is quite different than what the world assumes. Very, very different. Our identity is very different than what we assume. Our options are way better than we assume. As a matter of fact, everything, for instance, in this world is actually totally blessed. This very moment is actually total blessing rests upon all. And this is true for the whole universe and everything that ever arises or could arise. Total blessing rests upon all. What is this blessing? The blessing of absolute freedom. And that is, all is absolutely free every instant. Is not bound by time, space, process, or form at all. There is nothing that is bound by time, space, process, or form. Never will be. Never has been, never will be. This is the way it is right now, actually. This is the nature of reality. This is the nature of God. Absolute freedom. Now, we have updated information. The Holy Spirit has been directing my attention to a few things on the internet. And usually I don't do that, I haven't been doing that recently, but the Holy Spirit said, take a look, well, let's take another second look. And I came across some very interesting information which correlates with what I've been saying. What I've been saying is, before we reach July 2016, we want to be confirmed in our sidestepping. This is somehow, it's intuitively, when we went through July, we reached July of 2014, I felt something. I felt we have to be finished before this date, before this time, before July of 2016. I said, wow. Okay, so I know this is something very important with coming in maybe late June of 2016. Now, I can't quite remember whether it was June or July. It'd be on the safe side, be ready before June. But I believe for sure we don't want to go into July. We don't want to go into even late June, early July. We want to be finished in our confirmation of clarity by that time. So I say we have about 18 months to reach that. Now, it's very interesting that June 21st, 2016, that there's a very interesting date. There is a new theory and about the end times, and it is a theory that is gaining traction. And because this date, 2016, came to me, a very important late June, early July-ish, it corresponds to something very important. So it's gaining more traction in my way of looking at it, that 2012, December 21st, 2012, we said this is the end of the world. Okay. Now, the world didn't end, but the Mayans have a way of looking at the situation, and Christianity has another way of looking at it, but they may be talking about the same thing. And there's the Mayans may have been saying that the world ended at that date, and now there's a period of turbulence going into the new cycle, which begins after a seven-year period. And Christians could have be saying, well, the beginning of the turbulence begins on this, on 12/21/12, and it takes 7 years to complete in December 21st 2019. There's a book out, 219, Signs of the End Times, which gets into this. I don't have the book, but I just read a synopsis of it, and I believe that there's something there. There's something there because of the 216 date that I had intuitively. This happens to be smack dab in the 3.5 year midpoint of what the Christians would call the tribulation period. And this is supposedly when the Antichrist is going to come out into the world. And so there is a lot of stuff happening and has happened that some authors are pointing out now. And so credit to these authors that are pointing these out, the signs are being fulfilled. So I'm sticking with that 216, late June, early July. You want to be done. Let's just say done before late June is a good way of putting it. Done before late June. There's going to be some very pivotal event in that time frame, late June, early July. You want to be done before July, so late June, I would say, is the right way of putting it. So let's put it June 21st. We can put it June 21st. That's the midway point, basically the midway point. Although, if counting up the months, it might be a little bit this way or that way. I don't know if it's exactly 7 days or whatever, halfway, 365, but it's right there. So and at that point, after that halfway point, is when really the trouble really comes super severely. But leading up to this time, 18 month period, things should start getting real, real turbulent. I had a dream a couple nights ago, and I saw this horrible storm arise, and I managed to get free from it, sidestep it. I was on the ocean, and I looked, and I saw the waves, the storm surge, surging over in an area of land, and I identified the land. I said, hey, that's like, it's the Levant, you know, area. It's the Levant, which was called the Levant. In ancient times, it's kind of where Turkey goes into Syria, and then there's Lebanon there, that coast, ancient Phoenicia. It seemed to be in that area. It had something to do with Turkey and then the Levant. That area of the Mediterranean is in the Mediterranean, the eastern part of the Mediterranean, and it was getting battered by storm surge, and boats were being, the boat harbor was being overrun by this tempest, and was going into the land, and I was like, wow, this is really ferocious. Now, I didn't know anything about it. There's been some crisis in Turkey. I've been following the news for quite some time. I guess Turkey is really politically, socially in a very much a bad turmoil state. Greece is perhaps going towards the default or leaving the euro. That area. And then, of course, Syria, we know Syria. That Greece, Turkey, Syria, Levant area, and of course Israel is a little bit south, but that general area is where I saw the storm hitting so severely. So, I don't, maybe a lot of people think, oh, yeah, no, we're 2012, December 12, 2012 came and nothing happened, so we're No worries. It's not true. It's not true. Very likely that was the beginning of the 7-year tribulation period. That is very likely. Now, some Christians have said pre-tribulation rapture. Well, if this is the model, it didn't happen. Okay, it didn't happen. There's a great many more that read scripture as saying mid-tribulation rapture, mid-tribulation, and some post-tribulation. So it is possible that there'd be a mid-tribulation rapture, mid-tribulation sidestepping, which could come then in late June of 2016. That's possible. I wouldn't be surprised, actually, at all. Because based on what we're doing here, the clarity that we're getting here is so strong, so strong. It's like literally opening up a door to another realm, actually. The clarity of ascension, the clarity of truth, the clarity of supernature, you know, that's if we can choose this, choose a different marketing campaign, choose a different product to market. As I've said, this world that we see, this universe, is just a marketing campaign, marketing death to God, actually, saying, here, God, we have this wonderful gift for you. We've been working on it for a really long time. Hope you like it. Here you go. And God does. It's nothing there. There's no product there. I can't take it. There's nothing there. This is the humor about our situation is really... it's all a marketing campaign. That's all it is. This is all symbol, appearance, all this stuff is just our very clever, we're trying to work on this marketing campaign, thinking we'll finally find some very clever way for God to accept death. And thereby, we can claim we're greater than God. Because we created something that God didn't change, we changed reality, because there's no death in reality at all. Absolute freedom. Yeah, there's no such thing as death. Can it choose any moment, every single instant, it can choose any experience. Never bound, never forced to change its experiencing, never forced to not change it. See, this is reality. Never forced to change, never forced to not change its our experiencing. So, these things, now, we're told that we can't know the time or the date and all this. And I always said that's nonsense. Yes, we can know. We can know. My whole life I said, no, we can know. We will know. We will know ahead of time, actually. And this book, 2019, The End Times or something like that. I can't remember the author's name. I can put that in the description of this video, actually. He points out something very, very interesting. As the original Greek for no man knoweth the time or date is no man has knoweth. It's past tense, meaning before this time, no one knew the time or date. But then it's indicated the Holy Spirit will progressively make everything clear to us. So we should, as we get nearer the time and the date, we should be able to pinpoint it, actually. The past tense means before we didn't know it, but it leaves open the door for the grace of God to pinpoint it for us. Now, the preparations, spiritual preparations, are certainly very intense, at least here. I've always known my whole life that there is something for sure coming, and we've been warned about it. And we need to be spiritually prepared. Knowing the date, time, and the date, how does that spiritually prepare us? It doesn't do much of anything, except, you know, it gives us an impetus to get preparing more. Now, supposedly you don't want to be here in this world at the end of December 21st, starting then in 2019. That's when all hell breaks loose. This is one theory. It's quite plausible, actually. So, sidestepping, mid-rapture sidestep might be the ticket, actually. Could be the ticket. What is rapture, we ask? Well, in my opinion, the way I see it, it's going to the place that Jesus has prepared for us. Okay. Now, do I believe there is such a place? Yes, absolutely. First of all, I was taken to about close to 15 years ago. Taken to in my awareness, my attention, while my body was resting, I was taken to a realm I call the death free realm, supernatural realm, super nature, and shown this other realm, and it was quite amazing. And so I said, wow, where am I? This is not Earth. This is not even like the universe I'm used to. This is, nothing dies here. Everything is pristine. Everything's been pristine here forever, from the very beginning. And I started noticing all this, the attributes that were extraordinary. Okay, so there is another realm from my experiencing. Now, I also, just a couple of months ago, while the body was sleeping, had a meeting with someone that I interpreted as quite likely Jesus. And at the end of this talk, a little chit-chat and talking about history and previous times and all this stuff, and then he said, at the end, he said, would you like to come visit my place? My dwelling place. Would you like to come visit my house, my dwelling place, my place? And I said, yes, absolutely I would. So, and I said, where is it? And he said, well, it's just, and it was very, very, just on the flip side of where we were, like there's a fence sort of, and then it was right behind the fence where we were. And so you could see, you could say it's another dimension, actually, because in distance-wise, there was no distance to it. It was more like a something place where you go over the fence and there it is, like you shift. You can shift into it, like a shifting into another dimension. So, there again, I feel like there is another dimension, there is another realm we can shift into, actually, and avoid what's coming in this world. The signs are quite strong that prophecy is playing out. They're quite strong, actually. Keep in mind that a lot of prophecy they're looking at, it's spiritual warnings, okay? So, the problems and difficulties we have may be, you know, largely spiritual on this planet, going into a time of spiritual darkness. Some of it may play out in the physically, you know, in the physical, empirical realm here. Our senses are saying, oh, this is happening. But maybe not all of it. Maybe not all of it. I say that the war that's taking place in this world, World War III, is an ideological war more than anything. Ideological, I've said, it is cosmic corporate culture, cosmic corporate culture, CCC. That is incorporating this planet, taking over the planet, incorporating it, and bringing in a new civilization, a new way of doing things. It's now under corporate control. And this CCC is actually composed of a conglomerate of different cosmic races working together to accomplish the kind of agenda and goals that they want. Which is why we're being told, don't discriminate against anyone, even though they're really weird or different, or, you know, that's the worst sin possible. You know, there's no racism. It doesn't matter if someone looks very different than you. That's why little kids for the last 30, 40 years have been shown constantly cartoons with reptilian dinosaurs. This is a massive, massive push. I've been monitoring this, and I saw it start, and it's just been incredible. Wave after wave after wave of indoctrinating young people and public in general with dinosaurs, dinosaurs, dinosaurs. Now, what's the obsession with dinosaurs? I don't have the slightest interest in dinosaurs at all. But people think they're like super important, so why? Why? They've been extinct for how many hundreds of millions of years or something? I mean, a long time, right? So the kids just are obsessed with dinosaurs and reptiles, you know, reptiles. This is all indoctrinating young people, the younger generation, to feel comfortable around reptoid aliens, actually, who have somewhat of a, you know, humanoid form, except they have a scalar sort of skin, and they have some protuberances, I can't even say it. Maybe some have short tails, some of them have, you know, so they look, you know, kind of weird. But everybody's, the kids are going to say, oh yeah, there's my friendly little dinosaur. I love my dinosaur, how cute. And they're getting smaller, and then the cartoons, these little dinosaurs walking around interacting like they live here on Earth, you know. This is all part of the CCC's indoctrination program. Get this younger generation. See, the older generation, they've written us off. I'm part of the older generation. They don't care about us. We'll, you know, they'll deal with us in their way, those who are still here, you know. And we may not be here, actually. That's our plan. But they've written, we don't matter. We don't matter. Older generations don't matter generations anymore, because they've been indoctrinated that the older generation just don't get it. They're prejudiced, they're bigoted, they're intolerant, they're racist. You know, there's all these terrible words they keep screaming at us, you know, because they've been indoctrinated to accept reptoids, mantoids. I call them, some call them mantids, mantid, mantoids. I call them Pleiadians, all these different cosmic races of different forms of entities, you know, and with very different ways of beliefs and ways of behaving and stuff. That they've been conditioned to feel, oh, that's the way things are, and it's good. It's good. And anyone who doesn't like it is bigoted, very bigoted, you know, horrible, horrible person. You know, to say that, you know what, this planet Earth for humans is let, you know, let's keep planet Earth for humans. Oh no, that's exclusive. That's exclusionary. Very exclusionary. Now, I predicted on some videos in the past, I said, just you watch. They're going to start bringing dogs and animals into church. Okay? Just after I made that video, I start saying this. What happens? A dog shows up in church. Now it's a seeing eye dog. Okay? I said, okay, well, still it's interesting. Dog's making noises all during the, you know, the Mass, the Catholic Mass. And then last Sunday, in the middle of Mass, this big lady in a red coat comes in Mass. What is she doing? She's carrying a dog. What does she do? She sits in the front row holding this dog. And she's playing with the dog and looking. Of course, the kids are, you know, some of the kids are distracted. Oh, look at that dog. Oh, it's so cute. You know, I said, what in the heck is going on here? You don't bring a dog into Mass. You know, it's just, but this is what's happening. Animal planet, you know, pull us down into the animal nature, so to speak, and take our guidance from animals instead of divinity, you know, take our guidance from the so-called product we're trying to sell God, which is death, you know, instead of listening to God, and God says there is no death, all right? So right on cue, here come the dogs into church. I don't know, maybe they're going to have canine communion, huh? Probably, you know, probably they'll be demanding that. And they say, you don't give the dogs communion? You're exclusionary. You're excluding. That's prejudice. It's intolerance. It's discrimination. You're discriminating against my dog by not allowing me to bring the dog in here and have communion. Dog wants communion too. And of course, all the kids will be totally distracted, which is what they want. They want to distract the youth away from God. So the youth of the day has this feeling, a lot of them, that this is a badge of honor to be very atheistic, to be very turned away from divinity and towards tolerance, exclusion, diversity, tolerance, exclusion. I mean, inclusion, tolerance, inclusion, diversity, tolerance, inclusion, diversity. Well, whatever goes, you know, you just marry your dog or something. It's okay. It's all good. It's all diversity. So this is getting them ready for these different alien races actually living on this planet with all their bizarre, you know, bizarre customs. Bizarre to us for sure. And they just say, oh yeah, sure, yeah, that's normal. That's no problem with that. This is what it's for, actually. This is what's going on. So the CCC, three C's, cosmic corporate culture, very interesting. You know that bumper sticker you've been seeing for the last 6 years or so, that circle, sort of an arch like this, and then the American flag, you know, it's a political bumper sticker, you know, that one that's that has the current president, quote unquote president, has this bumper sticker, that circle with a white in the middle, and then the three red stripes, like it's supposed to be the American flag. Okay, you know that one. Everybody's seeing it. In Silicon Valley, like about every three cars seems to have that on it. You know, it's the center of the CCC, actually. Well, that stands for the CCC. You see, the C is like an arch, a semicircle, 180 degrees. If you turn that 90 degrees, okay, turn it 90 degrees, you get a C and then three red stripes, meaning three C's. which in red stripes symbolize communism or centralized planning, which is what the CCC is all about. So this current quote-unquote president represents the CCC here on this planet. Absolutely does. If you look at his background, it's the most mysterious, secretive background. Nobody really knows what the heck is going on. Some of us do, but you're not supposed to say or tell because it's bizarre beyond belief of most people. Anyway, he's an agent of the CCC. There's no question about it. The way he's acting is textbook blueprint. All of this is fine. You know, we're just pointing this out. I mean, the CCC, like anything, has their upside and the downside. You see, I mean, there's pluses and minuses. Okay, they think this is the answer. Okay, one world government, one world religion, centralized planning, super regulating bureaucracy. They feel this is the answer for this planet, for everyone, for the universe. They have their beliefs. And they believe this is going to elevate people, more tolerance, more acceptance, and help this planet ascend into cosmic culture and be able to trade and understand space travel and all this stuff. So yeah, they think eventually this will help us towards developing our full potential, on and on and on. Well, you know, you can point out stuff. You can say this is good, and then you can point out stuff to say this is bad. Just like humanity, you can point out good stuff and bad stuff too. Okay, it's just we're saying we need to be aware of what's going on. Now, is this current president the Antichrist? Is this the one that is? Well, a lot of people say yes. It's definitely definite possibility. Definite possibility. He's acting out the things in prophecy very, very clearly. We'll see. We'll see. It wouldn't be the slightest bit surprising if it turned out to be the case. And supposedly the Antichrist will be revealed in this June 2016 time frame. Sometime in June of 2016 is the Antichrist will somehow say, "Hey, I am God. I am here." Now, will this be someone that the Vatican introduces at that time, saying, "This is God coming back to Earth. This is the Messiah here." And some extraterrestrial, some Pleiadian or someone that looks like us, a Nordic or something. June of 2016. These are very real possibilities right now with the way the world is going. And are Christians being targeted? Some are, yeah. Is there a conflict? Will it be a conflict within Christianity? Most likely, it could very well be. So all this stuff that people are saying troubles are coming could very well happen. The trending is there. The trending is there for it. Especially if the Vatican produces this, Messiah figure and says, this is the Messiah here now, and we're going to put the world. We now turn our allegiance to this Messiah, not the Pope. The Pope turns over. When we say this is the last Pope, a lot of people say Malachi prophecies are true. A lot of them say they're bogus. Well, they're certainly interesting, to say the least. They're interesting beyond just being a forgery, as the Catholic Church claims, because there have been some pretty prescient prophecies in regard to the popes and their characteristics. So we're told that this pope is the last pope, the black pope's last pope. And how can that be the last pope, you see? See, this is something that people have been wondering. Well, here's the answer. Is the pope introduces an extraterrestrial messiah figure and says this is the messiah returning to the earth. This is the return of Christ. And therefore, I am no longer the vicar of Christ on earth. The church age has ended. And we now owe our allegiance. All Catholics now owe their allegiance. And they'll say all Christians and everyone on the earth owe their allegiance now to this Messiah figure. And that would be the end of the papacy, you see? Very interesting, right? Very, very interesting. The Pope keeps prattling on about how he only has a few years to live, or only a few years to go. He probably not going to be with this job much longer. What's he talking about? Well, that would make sense if he's turning it over to introducing a messiah figure, wouldn't it? He wouldn't be Pope anymore. He'd be done with the job. He'd be out of the job. He says he might resign. In fact, he says, in my health or circumstances, you know, if I can't do the job, whatever, I could resign too. So he's already telling us he's likely to resign in a couple years. And he's been saying this. A couple years from when he started saying this, this is going to be about possibly June 2016. I'm going to have to go back and look at that. But, you know, he has been mentioning this, right? And so it could very, he's sort of 2 or 3, he's not really putting it exactly, okay. But it would very easily fit into a June 2016 time frame of, you know, either introducing the Messiah or claiming that the Messiah is now here. You know, maybe he'll say the current president is the Messiah or something, I don't know, or someone else. But anyway, if that was true, the Messiah was here, then the Pope would certainly abdicate and say, our work is done. Our work is done. See how this is all fitting together? And the clues the Pope is dropping are very, very important for those who know what they're talking about. Along with the current President of the United States, who is actually way more informed about this stuff than you know, most people understand. He has a very interesting situation there. I won't go into it, but anyway. This is food for thought. This is food for thought. Now, the way I look at it, the people of the world are not prepared, spiritually prepared. They're not spiritually prepared at all. They really aren't. And that's what I've been trying to help out with, but it's not getting much traction up to this point. Understanding what supernature is for, what is it for? It helps us set down both the marketing campaign of death and the marketing campaign of life. We've been trying to market both of those to God, and neither one has a product to sell God at all, or even to give God. Reality is beyond life and death. It's beyond life and death. It's beyond good and bad. It's beyond duality. Again, in reality, there's no forced change, there's no forced unchange. So, or not changing. So we don't have to change our experiencing. There's no force to change our experiencing. There's no forcing to not change our experiencing. We can change if we want, we can not change it if we want. So, there you can't say that reality is life, eternal life in terms of the life we're talking about. It is just eternal. It is eternal isness, actually. It is eternal isness. We call it life. We can call it life. But then we get in a level of confusion with the term life as we think of it, which is a particular form lasting forever. That is not reality. There's nothing preventing us from having an experience forever. And there's nothing preventing us from changing at the next moment. So there's no forces acting upon us in reality. There's no forces acting upon isness to be anything other than isness and perfect freedom of isness. There are no forces at all working on them. So the supernature enables us to set down both marketing campaigns, marketing forced, the idea of forced change and the idea of forced non-change. Force change, force non-change, death, life, force change, death, force non-change, life. To set these marketing campaigns down together as one idea of marketing to God, yeah, marketing to reality. Reality doesn't need to be marketed to. There's nothing to market to reality, actually. Absolute freedom cannot market anything. So we're able to set them down. So supernature gives us this great blessing, this great blessing. And the more we understand that, the easier it is for us to accept it and say, oh, yeah, of course, yeah, I'm comfortable with this ideology. I'm familiar with it. So Jesus says, you want to come to my place? I say, sure, of course. I'd love to come to your place. As I say, I'd love to, absolutely. Because I know what a wonderful place is, how helpful it is. The helpfulness is wow, we were able to set down the fundamental abstract idea of marketing, marketing to God, marketing anything, marketing death, marketing life. Don't need it. See, don't need it anymore. And once we set that down, we're home, so to speak. Meaning, we now are comfortable functioning the way we were created to function, in the fullness of our functioning. And we're not, don't need to market anything to ourselves. Don't need to market anything to reality. But because of our severe familiarity with marketing campaigns, whether it's marketing death or life, we have a great problem with this, setting marketing campaigns down. We keep thinking, I got to market something to God. I got to market something. Well, we can market supernature to God, let's say that. Market the real world to God. Market supernature. Let's market supernature. It's neither marketing life, or neither marketing life nor death. It's marketing setting down marketing. Let's look at that. We're marketing setting down marketing. How would it be, God, if we, how would you like to buy this? Setting down marketing, no marketing. How would you like to buy no marketing? And pursue that campaign. And at the end of pursuing that campaign, you'll say, I'm so used to pursuing no marketing that I don't even need the campaign of no marketing anymore. So, everyone's totally blessed. We don't hate anyone. We're not reviling anyone, vilifying anyone here. Everyone is absolutely blessed by isness. Meaning, every so-called form you see is neither a form of life nor a form of death, and therefore it's not even a form at all. It's just a temporary appearance this instant. That's it. Totally, we're totally free to shift that appearance, to change the appearance, to experience something different. Any instant at all, and it can be any experience at all. We can even disappear like that, or whatever. All is completely fluid, actually. All is completely free. So there aren't any people, there aren't any things, there aren't any forms, there's no situations, there's no circumstances at all. Not even one. But we're marketing that there is. This is our marketing campaign, you see? And we have believed in our own advertising. That's the cardinal sin. Never believe in your own advertising is what they tell you on Madison Avenue. We've believed in our own advertising. So it's just a matter of waking up from that dream. But it's like when we started believing in our own advertising, we fell into a dream. Don't eat of the fruit in the middle of the garden, Don't believe in the advertising, the central, what you're marketing, don't believe in it. Just a dream, it's just a marketing campaign. Don't take it seriously. If you believe in your own marketing campaign, then you think you're subject to life and death. I like that. And so you fall asleep into a dream. So we want to be happy and take things light and not be heavy-handed or anything like that. Just be aware of what's going on. Covenant with the so-called covenant was supposed to start 12/21. If that was the beginning of the tribulation period, there should have been a covenant. And apparently, I believe this is the author of 2019, the end times or something like that. He said that John Kerry was appointed Secretary of State at that time, and that then his campaign of a covenant of peoples with Israel, supposed to be a peace, some covenant with Israel at that time, that could actually fit very much into a biblical prophecy. That is possible. I haven't researched that, but. And so this whole thing about peace treaties with Israel and stuff like this, all this stuff is percolating, boiling. Really, it's hot, isn't it? For sure. And so, We could be actually in the tribulation period right now. We could already be several years into it. It's quite possible we're already several years into it. Now, I was shown in a dream, again, almost maybe 15 years or so ago, or more, that all this stuff would happen during the time of the 44th president. At that time, I had no idea what number presidency we had. I never looked at presidents that way. I couldn't tell you who the 42nd president was or 41st. No idea. I just said, okay, I don't know. And then I didn't even realize that the present is the 44th president. I just came across that, but maybe a couple years ago, I said, oh wow, that's amazing. This is the time. And of course, if he had not been reelected, then it wouldn't have really, the time frame would not have fit well. So this, the entering into this dark tunnel, I saw that the second half of tribulation is the real dark part. So June of 2016, after June of 2016, I believe we're going to enter into the second half of the tribulation period, where it gets very nasty, very nasty. And like entering into a dark tunnel, and that's what I was shown. So as far as what I've seen, things are on track, very much on track. And I'm a generalist. I take information from everywhere, including dreams, including Holy Spirit pointing stuff out, including other authors' works, including scripture, including this, including that, and the whole thing. Truth is where you find it. I allow the Holy Spirit to fill in the whole bigger picture, the bigger context of the entire situation. When Jesus shows up in a dream and invites me to his place, I say, wow, I bet you the times are getting near, right? Otherwise, why would he have done that? So it is all starting to fit together, and a lot of people have done a lot of good work, so kudos to everybody who's been working on this. And it's becoming more and more and more and more, And there'll be a division among people who are aware this is going on and those who claim, oh, you're all completely insane. What are you talking about? This is just absolute tooth fairy stuff, complete nonsense. but it's, there's more information comes out. It's playing out. The game is playing out in a way that gives us pause to say, I'm going to pay a little more attention to what's the possibility? What are the options? Maybe there is a way to sidestep troubles in this world that could very well come. Now, it's very interesting. In another dream I had was this massive collapse. I'm still trying to parse that one together entirely. But the aftermath of that, there was a horrible dust problem in the world. All these huge boulders rolling across the land, huge boulders. Now, I do know that those who believe in pole shift theory have talked about the reason why you find massive boulders perched on top of mountains and hills and stuff. There's no way they could have been, the only way they could have been deposited there is through pole shift, likely, right, where Earth slips on its axis or something. Massive tidal waves, that's capable of moving huge rocks and throwing them everywhere. What I saw in the dream was these massive boulders just rolling across the land. It was just horrible. It was just insane. So it's possible that was a dream of a pole shift. That is possible. But anyway, in the aftermath of it, dust everywhere. Dust, terrible, terrible dust everywhere. in. I was able to escape the whole situation. So I do have dreams like where I'd be able to escape a situation and look back and see it and see, you know, this is what's happening. And then I was also shown another dream, a new heaven, a new earth. They say new heaven, new earth. The earth was remodeled. There weren't any oceans. This has also been prophesied, a world with no oceans. I didn't see any oceans. It was just rivers, lakes and rivers everywhere, but no oceans. I said, this is weird. It was a very flat world, like a cue ball, no mountains or valleys either, really. The whole world had been smoothed out. And then I saw people arriving here in spaceships and people coming out of the ground and then repopulating the planet and terraforming it with advanced technology. I saw all of this taking place. And the people were of different races. I walk among them, I was taking video, and they kind of said, what are you doing? And they said, you know, hey, don't like this. And I noticed their features. They were humanoid, but different. They were different. Their ears were different. Their nose were different. Their profiles were different. They were definitely different races, different cosmic races. And I saw them coming here in spaceships and coming down from the spaceships, just masses of these entities coming down into the world. And again, there were all different types and varieties. But I noticed these are not really humans. They're hybrids, they're crosses, some are different, you know, cosmic races, and they came down and they lived together on this planet. Maybe that's what the lion shall lie down with the lamb in this, you know, kingdom or something, is different cosmic races will live together on planet Earth in a fourth dimensional sort of situation. So, I would say, you know, it's a big likelihood that this happening, the way the cosmic corporate culture is functioning here, doing all the hybridization experiments they've been doing. They're trying to develop a new root race, as far as I understand, to populate a new planet, you know, the remodeled planet Earth, where what takes, you know, trying to take the best genetics of humans and mixing with the genetics from other cosmic races to produce a new root race, they call it. This is part of theosophy, too, talking about the stuff coming root race and things like that. So all of this, the signs, you know, if you weigh it, there's more weight to it than not. You know, the scales tip in that direction. We can say that. The scales are tipping in that direction more and more. We don't have to make absolute statements here. We do say that the scales are tipping more that way. We know the hybridization experiments going on for quite some time. There's an agreement between the CCC and the world leaders that this would be allowed to happen, and in return, they're sharing technology, various technologies. So there is this messianic complex. The current president has a very messianic complex, actually. He feels that he's some, I always noticed that the office of the presidency, he acts like it's beneath him, and he's just waiting for the real office that he's here for. This is my intuition about him. I just look and I say, hey, he's like, this is small potatoes for him, being the president of the U.S. He's bored. He's going out and plays golf. I'm bored. I'm here for something much bigger than that. What, the ruler of the world? Yeah, it seems like that's the goal. This could be the last president, just like the last pope. You could say that the Messiah is here. Maybe he says, I am the Messiah or something, and there's no more presidency, and there's an agreement between the Vatican, the United States, and China, and various places that we're now going to follow this one world leader, and we don't have a unified bureaucracy and all this kind of stuff. So the, you know, the Constitution is dissolved, and we have a new world global constitution and all this stuff. That's very possible. Now, they may use crises to bring this about. So it may be that this next 18 months is a time where there's a lot of turmoil. People are saying, wow, the world's just coming to an end. This is terrible. we could have an economic problem. It's possible. Oil keeps dropping down and dropping down and dropping down, and that could be a very ominous sign. The world economy is not necessarily fixed. They've been printing money like lunatics to make it seem like everything's fine, but it may not be so fine. This price of oil going down is certainly an ominous indicator that everything is not just fine. The demand is quite low. So maybe we've had this mirage of an economic recovery. Maybe things will collapse economically, politically. I know, like I said, that Syria, Turkey's in a very tense situation. Middle East is just a tinderbox. The whole world is potentially, things could fall apart quickly, actually. And then with that severe crisis in the world, people would say, we need a leader to unify the world. We say the global problems are gotten out of hand, and we need a new world economy, we need a new world religion, because religions, they'll blame fundamentalist evangelical Christians, they'll blame them for everything, as they have been doing for quite some time. And the Pope will get on board too, and say, yeah. He says, we agree, we need a leader to unify the world. And then someone is going to stand up and say, well, here he is. He'll say, here I am. Here I am. Oh, yeah, you can do it. Sure. Yeah, you know how to chair the, UN Security Council. You know how to chair the, you kind of fit right in. Let's have a global leader now. It's time. See, things are getting out of hand here. So they may be orchestrating these crises to be able to say, hey, we got to have it now. It's time. Can't wait any longer. So they could do that in the next 18 months. It is possible. It is possible. Don't put anything past the world at this point. It's interesting that the U.S. president has such a super high approval rating around the world. First, when he first elected, it was like off the charts. The rest of the world said, "This is our savior. This is our savior. I mean, this guy is going to save the world. He's going to heal the United States, put the United States back in its cage. The United States is going crazy. He's going to save us from that." And so he has an enormously high approval rating around the rest of the world. At least has been, where in the United States is a very different story, actually. There's so many evangelical Christians here, and so many people say, hey, wait a minute, this seems like we're going towards some kind of new world order here. What about the Constitution? He doesn't seem to care about the Constitution. Very convenient being a constitutional lawyer is finding ways to get around the Constitution. So the rest of the world may already be saying, hey, we already know who our Messiah is. We'll accept him, no problem. See? It's only the United States that says no. That's quite funny. Already signed this date on September, what was it, 21st or 24th, some UN Security Council resolution to combat travel of people going to combat zones, terrorists, going to different combat zones. No flying, no traveling, no contributions, no this, no that. And all the nations of the world signed on, and that was chaired. The idea was chaired and pioneered, supposedly, by the United States president. And they basically said, okay, we'll give you authority to implement this, basically, and to push this through. What is that except a global world government? It's the foundation of it, actually. Now, I don't know exactly why the Christians are so upset about stuff, because if they're raptured, what does it matter to them? the Christians should be saying, this is great, love it, wonderful. The time is coming very near now in our lives. We'll be out of here. That should be the attitude. We'll be out of here. And the world's going to go to hell, we know that. And we know the Armageddon, the final battle, and all the troubles, and the world will be remade, etc. So they should not be freaking out about what's happening. They just should be focused on, okay, where are we going? And how could we adjust to where we're going? See, that's the question. How come, where are we going, and how can we adjust to where we're going? This is the question. So I don't get involved in politics and social issues and all this kind of stuff. It's for me, I don't see myself being here dealing with that kind of stuff, actually. It's not my concern. It's not my lookout. Let the dead bury the dead. You know, let those who are marketing death, let them deal with the marketing campaign. It's not my lookout. However they want to market death doesn't matter to me. There's endless ways to market it. I mean, there's permutations, all sorts of permutations. Packaging, repackage it this way, that way. I'll package it however you want. I'm dropping the marketing campaign altogether, along with the marketing campaign of life, too, you see. which you could say a lot of Christians are marketing life, you see. And this is duality. It's not, marketing life is not the answer. Jesus said, why do you call me good? I'm not good. don't call me good. That's good and bad is the duality. Again, in reality, you're not forced, no force to change, no force to not change. So the idea of marketing death, which would be forced change, is not true. And the idea of marketing life, which would be forced no change, is also not true. So the Christians are marketing life, 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 life. And the rest of the world, a lot of the world, is marketing death, 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 death. Not all of it, but this is a good example. And the Christians say, well, we're right and you're wrong. And I say, I'm saying, take a time out, you know, because now it's marketing to God, which is wrong. It doesn't matter which one you're marketing. They're both equally mistaken. Same mistake. It's the same mistake. It's basically saying that perfect freedom is not perfect freedom. That is the root of the mistake. So this mistake takes on two branches in marketing life and marketing death, but it's actually one mistake of the attempt to change freedom, change what God created. That's the mistake. One mistake with this dual marketing campaign. So this is what we need to look at. This is what Jesus helps us with. Okay, this is what Jesus is not here to market life. Okay, no, that's a mistake. And maybe that's why he allowed himself to be crucified, to tell you the truth. I don't know, it's just a thought to throw out there. Is he wanted to show the world, hey, no, I'm not marketing life. No way. And he's not marketing by his actions in the world. He was clearly was not marketing death either. But maybe he may have said, look, I want to make clear to you, I'm also not marketing life, so I'll allow the crucifixion to take place. And then the resurrection said, okay, now let's get to work on this. So I know a lot of Christians are thinking that Jesus is, you know, marketing life, going to come back, destroy all those people here and do all this. But no, I don't see it that way at all. It's not been my experience of Jesus or his teachings. Though Jesus clarifies that this one mistake with this dual marketing campaign, the desire to change reality, desire to play God, prime creator, say, let's change reality. That's the mistake. That's the mistake we made. And so he's here to clear that mistake up, show us how can we dissolve our continuity fear so that we don't feel as though letting go of marketing altogether, let go of trying to change reality, won't scare us. We'll say, oh, that's fine, no problem. We'll know how to function in reality. It won't be freak us out, because right now we only know how to function as marketers. You see, we're marketing. All this is marketing. This body, what we do, everything. It's all a dance for God. We're trying to sell God on this. We're trying to sell God. Everyone, this whole thing is trying to sell. We're sellers. We're marketers. Saying, hey, God, you need this. God, we're going to get this just right for you. Don't worry. Don't worry. We almost got it right for you. We'll get it right. We're almost there. This is all, you know, marketing. And so we're used to that, and we're not used to functioning in, you know, in the pure, the freedom that is. So, this certainly gives things a different perspective, doesn't it? interesting. The Christians may have been those who have been marketing life. And then when Jesus coming down here to die for us here, they said, oh, great. We can be free of marketing life too, right? And then other people in the world looking at Jesus say, oh yeah, he's this nice rabbi telling us how to live here in peace and everything. In other words, marketing death. They say, oh, good. And by his resurrection, they can say, oh my gosh, he's not marketing death. Good. They're trapped in marketing death. Oh, no, he's just a rabbi. He was here marketing death. Yeah, no problem. And some Christians will say, misinterpret and say by his resurrection, no, he's just marketing life. That's what he's doing. He's marketing life. But the wise ones will say, no, he was neither marketing death nor life. Neither one. He was showing us how to be free of the one mistake of trying to change freedom by claiming either that there's some force that force change or force non-change. See? Neither. So just putting this out for everyone's consideration here. Pretty heavy stuff, isn't it? It just changes everything. It's like a spiritual pole shift, actually. You know, we need to make a spiritual pole shift before there's any cosmic pole shift, if it were to occur. New way of looking at the whole situation, isn't it? Absolutely new way of looking at Jesus. Yeah, taping outside here. Dark, cold. January 5th. I think, yeah, it's the 5th. Let me check. Yeah, it's the 5th. We're making great progress, super, super fast progress. I know a lot of people don't have the time to watch all these videos. That's a shame, because this is when the rapid progress is happening, as I said it would. But you'll be able to get up to speed, hopefully, at some point, as the message becomes clearer and clearer and clearer. Maybe you'll be able to, you know, absorb it. I hope so. This is wow, isn't this? Full stop on the wow. Wow is a practice. So you call it a religion, or you call it a practice. It's a practical religion, a practice. Religion just means discipline related to the divine. So this is practice related to the divine. Wowism means full stop on the wow as we make the spiritual pole shift like this. It's like, wow, we just completely reinterpreted Christianity. And talking about this cosmic, what's happening in the world, and all of this is just given a complete new context, just like that. Wow. See, if that isn't a wow, maybe it's not getting through. It's just monumental. And so I'm just doing this in real time. I'm experiencing the wow along with you, because this is new to me. These ideas just arise with clarity as I'm willing to give them out to the world. They just come out. I see them for the first time, and I just say, wow, that's really cool. That's really amazing. Jesus was actually coming here to show us he's not marketing death and not marketing life. Neither one. Wow. This may have just been overwhelming to some. Now don't go eat too much. I've put myself on a diet during these times, because I know if I don't, I'm going to overeat like crazy. Because one of the ways we try to deal with this wow staggered mindness is to eat. It tends to, like, somehow calm us down or seems to help, you know. So if I hadn't gone on a diet, I would just be, you know, way overweight. I already am overweight, because I went through about a month and a half of such intense progress that I started eating to try and contain it. It was so intense. I said, I can't keep doing that. So I have to make a greater effort of will to contain these landscape shifts, these global shifts, polar shifts, spiritual pole shifts here. Because once you see this, you never look at Christianity the same again. You never look at religious teaching the same again. Christ, who could it be? Well, it's either going to be somebody that's very well known already and the world already accepts them as they could, you know, say, we really trust this person to do a great job. Or it's going to be some sort of ET, actually. Because within a time of like 18 months, you can't have some unknown politician arise to such prominence, I wouldn't think, you know, at this point. It's possible, but it's unlikely. It is probably somebody people are already familiar with, has a track record. Because a novice, people say, ah, I'm not sure. But someone already has a track record, a background. And they say, yeah, we can trust this person. They can do a great job. Or an ET, where the various leaders of the world say, this ET represents a superior race to us. And this is their leader. He is sent here to heal the world and solve all our economic, social, global problems. And so we're going to give our allegiance to this ET. And that would just, you know, be right away. It would be kind of be the officialdom would decree it. That also could take place. Don't think a lot of Christians wouldn't go for that one, would they? I don't think they'd go, unless they can convince it's Christ, it's Jesus, you know. Maybe they've cloned somebody. The ET race, some of them are very good at cloning and genetic stuff, and they can, so they may make someone look the way that we think that Jesus looks, and so people look, oh my gosh, it's Jesus, he's returned, and if the Pope says this is Jesus, he's returned, and maybe the Pope might know it's an ET clone or something, but they'll, you know, for the sake of convincing the world, the Pope may say, oh, this is Jesus, and the world may believe it. This is Jesus, his return. And, you know, other traditions, certainly, some, like Islam, various traditions recognize Jesus. Now, not all traditions do that. But they do have traditions of a return of some savior, world savior. I think Buddhism, Hinduism, and Kalki avatar returning, you know, incarnation of Krishna or something. And also, I'm not sure about all traditions exactly, but, you know, it is certainly plausible, isn't it? That's one plausibility. The other would be a secular leader, a bureaucrat, a head of a global bureaucracy, someone who has experience, and people would say, okay, I know you can do this. Also, someone very charismatic who could convince people, don't worry, I know the answers, I know the answers. So, very interesting, you know, those profiles, you know, there's some that fit a profile, you know, you could say someone who thinks they know better than anyone else about everything, messianic complex, and, you know, they say, oh, don't worry, I can solve all the problems, I just get everybody working together and get everything regulated here, let's get, you know, let's write a new world constitution, let's get a new world religion, someone who's not really beholden to any particular religion, but could, you know, convince Islam, convince Christianity, you know, hey, let's get together on this. Who might fit that profile? You know. Interesting, isn't it? Not saying, we're just saying, you know, just looking at the profile. You're not supposed to profile, right? Oh, that's in part of the CCC, too. Oh, there's a reptoid. Oh, don't profile that. Well, I gotta check. What's this reptoid? You know, they act a certain way. Let's make sure they're on the up. Oh no, that's profiling. Can't do that. There's someone with scaly scales, these skin and a tail. I think we're supposed to round up the reptoids. Oh no, that's profiling. You can't do that. I need to like detain a human instead and say, human, are you a reptoid? Let me check you out. Oh, you're not, huh? Okay, but there's a reptoid right past there. No, I can't profile. I can't profile. You know, all this stuff that society is being engineered by the CCC to allow alien races to cohabit here, actually. That's what's coming. That is what's coming. And again, I've been amongst them. I was taken in the future somehow, and shown some sort of movie or somehow, and I did see all these different races from the cosmos. And, you know, it's weird, a little weird, but not that weird, you know. They're kind of arrogant and not so friendly, some of them, and some are all excitable, and they actually say, there's Jesus, there's Jesus. And there was some Messiah figure there, and everyone was running to get instructions from this Messiah-like figure. And I said, what are you talking about? That's not Jesus. Anyway, so there's going to be some, even in the future of this planet, there's going to be some Messiah figure, some figure that people go to for, you know, instruction to deal with, you know, the new planet and stuff. So, interesting times we live in. But all of it, very irrelevant, because what, it's only a marketing campaign. See, the fourth dimensionals don't realize it's all a marketing campaign. Maybe eventually they will. Maybe this is a way for the masses to gradually get up to speed on all this stuff. See, that's possible. But for some of us, we're already up to speed. We don't need to sidestep the whole fourth dimensional situation. Just sidestep it. Very possible. I don't need it. I don't feel like I need it at all. I realize it's just this, just all a marketing campaign, dualistic marketing campaign, good and bad, marketing death, marketing life, you know, that's what's going on. And so, once you see that, what do you need this for? Don't need it. It's not interesting anymore. The thrill is gone, you know, the bloom is off the rose. You say, ah. It's just, God, there's nothing, marketing nothing. God can never buy it, this non-existent product. It's futile. It's a waste of time. Now, if we enjoy just for fun, we're doing it, but it's not that much fun, actually. Once you realize it's futile, there goes the fun out of it. Air's out of the balloon. So, we bring humor and lightness in us to help with the wow. To help with the wow. You see, it helps a lot if the mood is light and like this. Whereas if it's all fear and hate and attack and stuff, and yeah, this stuff, then you get dense and pulled down, and then you feel even more like attacking because you feel more vulnerable. Whereas if it's very light and full of grace and love and humor and you know, smiling, and you just say, yeah, this is great, seeing all this is wonderful. And you don't feel on the defensive so much. You don't feel so dense and destabilized and confused and threatened and all this kind of stuff. You don't feel threatened. You say, this is all great, okay, fine, no problem. We'll just sidestep it and just a marketing campaign. It's no big deal. I see duality. I see this. Okay, great. It's funny. Just all playing these roles, all these actresses and actors have their masks on, playing the roles, and this silly game is playing out, and just playing more of this marketing campaign, and it's all ridiculous. We're all blessed, always, and in the instant, everyone's blessed right now, this instant, so there's nothing to worry about. The blessing never leaves us. Yeah. So, not hurling insults or threats or anything like that. We're loose, we're relaxed, hanging loosely, freely, and in good humor. At the same time, being very informed, being very wise, more and more wise, more and more wise. Ah. So, good work by all, good work by all, that is for sure. And a lot of people are putting the pieces together, you see. That's what happens. Generalists are able to put the pieces together, you see. There's some who do detailed research, and there's some that take this research and put it together. And there's others that take these put together and put that together, you know. So, and that this all helps. This all helps with that. Okay. Noises in the dark. okay. Well. So hopefully this helps with the wow. I mean, we've covered just an enormous amount of territory now, and. Try to just smile about, you know, just smile. It's funny. Marketing a non-existent product is very funny, actually. Especially because we don't have to. Especially because we're totally free. Trying to get free is funny because we're already free. Trying to liberate someone else is funny because they're already free too. There's nothing to be liberated, actually. Except from our delusion that we're not already liberated. We're not already free. That's it. And of course, our continuity fear gets in the way of that because they say, if I'm not marketing, I probably don't exist. I don't know what to do if I'm not marketing. So we need to, you know, let that fear be evaporated. Hopefully, I believe supernature helps with that. And vision of oneness helps. And spiritual realization helps with that. Yeah, and so we're just getting familiar with the territory here, getting the familiar. And so, blessings to everybody. Stay in a good mood. Stay in good humor. Don't go attack. Don't get angry at people. Be above the fray. Be relaxed. Be smiling. Be beaming. Yeah, it's all good. And again, be happy. That stuff's happy. You know, it means we're out of here pretty soon, right? It should mean that. It should mean that. If you prepared. As Jesus said, the 10 virgins prepared for the bridegroom, and 5 went and got oil, and the other 5 lazy didn't get oil. And then when it was time for the bridegroom came, and the ones, they said, we need more oil, our lamps are going out. And the ones that got the oil said, sorry, you know, we need oil for keep our lamps going. So you got to go buy some at the bazaar. So they went out, bought some, and came back. The door was closed. The door was already closed. They said, let us in. They said, no, I don't know you. He didn't prepare. Did not prepare. So we're supposed to prepare. We're supposed to be wise and prepared. So that's what we're doing. That's what we're doing. Don't waste your time arguing with anybody. Don't waste your time in hostility with anybody. Don't attack. Don't get involved. Just keep full stop in the wow. Just say, wow, I'm getting free. This is great. This is great. Just stay with that wow. Wow feeling. Okay. Very great. That's it.